Yellow like sun and moon, revered for its aesthetic and metallurgic properties for thousands of years, gold is still today one of the most sought-after precious metals. There's no question about it. For better or for worse, gold has played a unique role for humanity. Today we will explore the fascinating history of a metal that, like and perhaps more than iron, has influenced the destiny of all civilizations that have followed one another on Earth in recent millennia. Trying to answer the question that most likely you will have asked yourself from time to time, what is the origin of gold? Why do we find it on our planet? From the Neolithic of the Middle East to the Bulgarian necropolis in the 4th millennium, from the Egyptian pharaohs to the Spanish conquistadors, the allure of gold, its powerful effect on us, has been consistent and unmistakable. In fact, the Egyptians called gold the breath of God, and it's not just the ancients that held gold in high esteem. What myths made gold such a prized commodity, and what factual properties still support it as a precious metal to this very day? First and foremost, what makes a precious metal is its rarity. Rarer than silver or copper, two other metals mined since antiquity, its value was proportionally larger. Second, gold has fantastic properties. It does not tarnish, it is very easy to work with, can be drawn into wire, hammered into thin sheets, it alloys with many other metals, can be melted and cast into highly detailed shapes, has a wonderful color and a brilliant luster. All of these properties could be harnessed since ancient times, like today, just by heating gold nuggets at high temperatures and using simple tools like hammers or molds. In short, gold is very memorable, so it shouldn't come as a surprise that its main use is in jewelry. Since time immemorial, the noble metal's resplendent luster allows it to be designed into the world's most coveted and exquisite jewelry, fit for queens and kings. Today, most of the gold that is newly minted or recycled is used in the manufacture of jewelry. About 78% of the gold that's available, as opposed to stored, each year is used for this purpose. Because gold is highly valued and in very limited supply, it has long been used as a medium of exchange or money. The first known use of gold in transactions dates back over 6,000 years. The first gold coins were minted under the order of King Croesus of Lydia, a region of present-day Turkey, in about 560 BC. Gold coins were commonly used in transactions up through the early 1900s, when paper currency became a more common form of exchange. The United States once used a gold standard and maintained a stockpile of gold to back every dollar in circulation. Under this gold standard, any person could present paper currency to the government and demand in exchange an equal value of gold. Possibly gold's greatest use to mankind didn't become evident until early last century, when its fantastic electrical conductivity properties came to light. Solid-state electronic devices use very low voltages and currents which are easily interrupted by corrosion or tarnish at the contact points. Gold is a highly efficient conductor that can carry these tiny currents and remain free of corrosion, which is why electronics made using gold are highly reliable. A small amount of gold is used in almost every sophisticated electronic device. This includes cell phones, calculators, personal digital assistants, global positioning system units, and other small electronic devices. But the gold is able to amaze us with a bunch of other strange features. So before trying to explain its origin, here are some curiosities. Enjoy them. Gold is the only metal that is yellow or golden. Other metals may develop a yellowish color, but only after they have oxidized or reacted with other chemicals. The chemical symbol for gold is Au, from the Latin word arum, meaning shining dawn, and from Aurora, the Roman goddess of the dawn. Gold is a noble metal. It is relatively unreactive and resists degradation by air, moisture, or acidic conditions. While acids dissolve most metals, a special mixture of acids called aqua regia is used to dissolve gold. The atomic number of gold is 79, which means there are 79 protons in the nucleus of every atom of gold. The melting point of gold is 1064 degrees Celsius. Gold is extremely ductile. 1 ounce of gold can be stretched to a length of 8 kilometers. The resulting wire would be just 5 microns wide. Malleability is a measure of how easily a material can be hammered into thin sheets. Gold is the most malleable element. 1 ounce of pure gold, 28.35 grams, could be hammered into a single sheet of 9 square meters. A sheet of gold can be made thin enough to be transparent. Gold is one of the densest metals found on Earth. A cubic meter of gold weighs 19,300 kilograms, far heavier than lead, 11,340 kilograms per meter cubed, and not far off the densest metal, osmium, 22,650 kilograms per meters cubed. It is estimated that 142,000 tons of gold have been mined throughout history. Over 90% of the world's gold has been mined since the California Gold Rush. The coffin found in Tutankhamun's tomb contained around 1.5 tons of gold. The average human body contains 0.2 milligrams of gold. Gold ranks 75th in order of abundance of the elements in the Earth's crust. Fort Knox holds 4,600 tons of gold. Today's gold price is $57.22 per gram. The visors that protected Apollo 11 astronauts during the first moonwalk was gold-coated. Cool, isn't it? But at this point, it's time to answer the last question. When was the gold we are finding in the Earth's crust formed, and where did it come from? Has it always been there, or has it not? The topic is really thorny, and even today has aspects not well understood. What we know exactly is this. Gold, like all other heavy elements existing in nature, can be formed only in thermonuclear reactions of extraordinary power. And in nature, there is only one place capable of this, the atomic furnace inside the stars. Could this be the origin of gold? Maybe. Let's try to understand it by retracing the whole process of the formation of a star. All the stars start life largely composed of immense balls of compressed gas, mainly hydrogen, the first element produced after the Big Bang. Clouds of stellar hydrogen condense to form a swirling mass, and the inward pressure is held in check by the outward pressure of the compressed gas. The pressure and friction causes incredible heat, resulting in a nuclear reaction at the center of the mass. Through a complex series of reactions, the hydrogen ignites and a star is born. Over billions of years, as the hydrogen is used up, outward pressure falls enough to allow gravity to squeeze the central core even tighter, causing greater pressure and temperature. At around 1 billion degrees, helium atoms are forged. As this element is devoured in the nuclear furnace, the core continues to contract and increase internal temperatures until the helium nuclei fuse to form carbon atoms. The process continues until further fusion reactions lead to oxygen, neon, and other elements materializing. By now, the density of the core is around 50 tons per cubic centimeter, compared to the Earth's average density of 5.5 grams per cubic centimeter. With a temperature of around 2 billion degrees, neon fuels a fusion reaction to form silicon, a major component of Earth. As each new element is consumed, so the energy return steadily declines, and the star changes, not every 10,000 years or even every year, but first on a monthly, then daily, and finally an hourly basis. The last stage is reached when the nuclear reaction produces an iron core, a more stable element without the ability to burn. The core by now is typically 200 kilometers across and very dense. It is estimated that a teaspoon will comprise around a trillion tons of matter. 6,000 teaspoonfuls, or 30 liters, would weigh as much as the entire mass of Earth. The star with little nuclear energy remaining to support its own weight contracts so forcefully under gravity that even atoms are overcome. The trillions and trillions of tons of material surrounding the core rushes inward at tens of thousands of kilometers an hour, colliding with the now solid core. The resulting shockwave, like nothing seen on Earth, travels outward and is accompanied by a burst of neutrinos formed in the dying moments. The combined energy of the shockwave and neutrinos transform the star's outer layers into an intense stellar furnace. It is in this environment that heavy elements beyond iron are forged in a mad scramble of hyperactive atoms. Then the star literally disintegrates in the form of a supernova. Iron atoms, along with every other element, are blasted into space in a nuclear holocaust beyond anything imaginable. The star will shine with the intensity of 10 billion of our suns, at least for a few days. Fading within weeks, all that remains of the star is a huge cloud of gas and dust containing the new elements. From this cloud, which in astronomy is called nebula, will condense in turn other stars called second-generation stars, which will incorporate and recycle all the new elements bequeathed by the stars that have preceded them. But be careful. Among the heavy elements in the nebula, there will be no trace of gold. At most, we will find iron. Until a decade ago, it was believed instead that any star massive enough at the end of its existence as a supernova would be able to form elements even heavier than iron, such as gold. But soon it was realized that to succeed would require energy much greater than that developed by a normal supernova event. And on August 17, 2017, astronomers had proof of their theory. Scientists, in fact, have for the first time seen the collision of two neutron stars in the galaxy NGC 4993, located nearly 130 million light-years from Earth. But the merger of the two neutron stars is more than fireworks. It's a factory. Using infrared telescopes, astronomers studied the spectra, the chemical composition of cosmic objects of the collision, and found that the plume ejected by the merger contained a host of newly formed heavy chemical elements, including gold, silver, platinum, and others. Scientists estimate the amount of cosmic bling totals about 10,000 Earth masses of heavy elements. The discovery seemed to confirm that neutron star mergers were responsible for the production of most of the heavy elements found in the universe. But certainties, even in astronomy, last the space of a morning, and new observations already suggest that the number of possible collisions between neutron stars has been greatly overestimated, and that is therefore necessary to assume cosmic phenomena even more energetic to justify the presence in the universe of so much gold. Whatever the cosmic origin of gold, to fully answer the initial question, we still have to explain its presence on our planet. It is true that it would be enough to say, as we have already done, that our solar system, sun, planets, and everything else was formed from dust rich in heavy elements left as an inheritance from stars of previous generations. However, there is a problem. In fact, as you already know, our planet was formed about 4.5 billion years ago, through a process of accretion that lasted millions of years, made by attracting dust and planetesimals that met in its orbit around the Sun. The energy released by this incessant supply of matter then began to produce heat, so much to produce the young Earth in an agglomeration of molten rock, homogeneous and undifferentiated. The high temperatures also fed by the natural radioactivity of the elements present reached and exceeded 1500 degrees centigrade. And this state of fluidity led the heavier elements such as iron, nickel, and gold to slowly sink towards the nucleus, separating from lighter materials which were pushed to the outer layers. So if 4.5 billion years ago heavy elements left the Earth's crust to form the metallic core of our planet, how come iron, nickel, and gold are still in abundance in mines around the world? The answer is very simple. After the Earth's crust cooled, solidifying, there was a period from 4.2 to 3.8 billion years ago in which the meteorite bombardment resumed with great intensity. During this interval, a disproportionately large number of asteroids are theorized to have collided with the early terrestrial planets in the inner solar system, including Mercury, Venus, Earth, and Mars. And it was the late heavy bombardment, as it was then called, that brought back to the Earth's surface most of these minerals that our planet had lost earlier. In short, we are telling you that all the gold we know, from what we wear to what we use in computers, from the funeral mask of the sarcophagus of Tutankhamun to the ingots locked up in Fort Knox. In short, all the gold in this world is something that comes from the stars and from asteroids that devastated the Earth 4 billion years ago.